The sound design of Animal Crossing is often overlooked,
but carries 80% of the game's tone, charm, and relaxation prowess. Well, am I biased because I'm a sound designer and teacher myself? Maybe, but do I care? No. And in today's episode, we're going to be looking at the game design techniques that actually make this possible. So, spoiler warning from this point onwards, guys, and welcome to the anatomy of Animal Crossing. Often considered just a background element to accompany and accentuate visuals, sound design is actually immensely important. It can be used to instantly communicate where the player is, the function of objects, or even the intent and emotional state of NPCs through sound alone, accessing a sense that we use day in, day out, making it the perfect medium for providing information to the player invisibly. Because humans often process sound subconsciously, and due to this, players and game designers alike often overlook the importance of sound design. But remove it and the entire illusion of a game crumbles. Pick your favorite game and just turn the sound off. See how weak those jump scares become, how pathetic those weapons feel, how emotionless those characters now seem, and how disengaged you rapidly become. There are a lot of techniques used to invisibly influence a player through sound, and I'm going to be covering all of them in future episodes. But today, I wanted to introduce some beginner concepts, and I couldn't think of a better and more relaxed setting to do it in than Animal Crossing. Before we dive into the sounds of Animal Crossing's world, we need to think about what the driving force of Animal Crossing actually is. What are the developers attempting to do? Well, I'm sure most of us will agree that's to encourage the player to relax and ultimately feel positive. Every aspect of its design driving this forward, arriving on your own hand-picked and secluded island, ready to be tended and shaped however you desire. The restrictions and boundaries placed upon the player are lapsed and casually waved off. You're encouraged to play at your own pace, never rushed or hounded. I and many other players feel a sense of calm and serenity while playing, when effectively completing simple fetch quests and menial labor on a slave island ran by a mad money laundering tanuki. Again, if we completely eliminate sound from the picture, we can see that the game's animations are incredibly simple. Gameplay might be considered repetitive, time-gated busy work, but it never feels like this. But why? Well, as many of you already know, this charm and atmosphere is largely driven by the music. Because music can be an incredibly effective emotional guide. When to feel tense, when to feel heroic, and when to feel calm. This is done in many different ways, using techniques such as Friedrich Marpoeg's acoustic expressions of emotional states as a guide to shepherding the player on how to feel. But that's a huge video on game music specifically for another time, so keep an ear out for that in the future. But so much of the character and charm of Animal Crossing is communicated directly through its subtle emotional sound effects. When designing sound effects, there are three simple categories: natural, informational, and emotional. For example, natural sound design is done so that the player won't notice the absence of it, because if it's not there, it would just feel wrong. Doors creaking when they open, wind blowing through the trees, and your footsteps. Neglect to include any of these natural sound elements, and it just feels wrong. They don't serve any immediate purpose, but they are essential. Informational sound, on the other hand, is used to convey information. Painful grunts, hit markers, or the beeps and boops of your Nook burner phone, each demanding your attention and telling you something. And finally, emotional sound design, which is used to elicit an emotional response from the player, be it fear, joy, or sadness. Now, these aren't strict rules by any means. Any given sound we create can fit into multiple categories at once, and it's encouraged to give them multiple uses. And the simple thing that makes Animal Crossing sound and feel so cozy is that it brings each and every sound effect it makes back into this emotional camp through the use of ultimately simple music theory. One of the techniques used to guide the emotion of music is called tone, a set of rules about which notes you should and probably shouldn't use if you want the listener to feel a certain way. But sound designers can use this too, the most simple being major and minor scales. Major scales are usually considered happy, and minor scales are considered sad. Finally catching a fish, positive. Whiffing an axe swing, negative. And nearly all sound effects used in Animal Crossing utilize major scales to encourage positivity, turning all of its informational sound effects into emotional ones too, constantly attempting to keep the player in this happy, calm state in everything that they do. Catching a bug, browsing the shops, or using your phone to pay off your blood debts, it's all positive. But a huge aspect of this game, something you do more than anything else, is talking, bringing us to the most important part of Animal Crossing sound design, voices. One of the most famous aspects of Animal Crossing, and the part that gets me the most excited, is how its characters talk, and their voices sound weird but familiar. So how have they done this? Well, replicating voices in games has been tricky business since day one. Due to memory limitations, we used to utilize single tones or beeps to imitate speech, and this has carried on as a kind of tradition and cheaper alternative to paying voice actors. But Animal Crossing feels different. Even though they're seemingly speaking gibberish, it's calming and eerily understandable, but how did they make a fake language that felt real? It's actually incredibly simple but genius and makes me stupidly giddy. Each voice actor for their respective region recorded a sound phonetically for every letter of the alphabet. N's became N and L's became L, for example. This can be seen in action via the in-game keyboard. Then, when a character speaks, each letter is transcribed and played phonetically. This isn't a one-for-one translation, and this is then sped and pitched up, transforming it into the cute voices we know and love today. This is the precise reason that the voices of Animal Crossing's residents feel so familiar. They are literally speaking to you, and subconsciously, it all makes sense to us due to the linguistic concept called prosody. Prosody is the patterns of stress and intonation in any given language. Rhythm and pitch are the most important aspects to convey character, emotion, and the appearance of a structured language. When prosody isn't managed correctly, it feels unnatural.
Oh, Barry!
That was too close. You were almost a Jill sandwich.
You're right. Barry, thanks for saving my life.
But the animals' voices are altered, using pitch modulation and specific rhythms to match the intonations of human speech, making it feel natural and incredibly easy to follow and read along to, even when the text is moving incredibly fast. Animal Crossing's developers have found a way to create its own unique language, but keep it designed in a way that keeps its players relaxed and following along. But at the end of the day, as natural as it feels on its own, it's still effectively gibberish. We can't discern emotion through these voices alone, so the developers need to find a way to convey the emotional intent of its characters through its sound effects. We can do this using custom effects to imply whatever we want through pitch, attenuation, and frequency control. Modulating the pitch of a voice lower or higher can be used to imply surprise, haste, or frustration. By adjusting the attenuation or the volume of certain lines, they can appear hushed, worried, or shocked. And frequency control. The frequencies of all sounds come in low, mid, and high ranges, and by cutting out certain frequencies such as the highs or the lows, we can convey so much like distance or completely new environments. When these things don't work, they use sound effects using the same major and minor scales to instantly communicate shock, joy, or worry, or anything the character might be feeling, allowing them to listen to these voices, feel a connection, and instantly understand a character's emotional state simply by using sound. Most of the time, the praise is placed on games that use the highest quality assets, the best animations, or the biggest environments, but I think Nintendo should be praised for how much they do with so little. The techniques they're using for its sound design are so incredibly basic, but done flawlessly. Using it as a tool to better help its players learn, connect with its characters, and ultimately, relax. And as biased as I am, sound is not the be-all and end-all. It's one piece of the huge puzzle that makes up game development, but I believe it doesn't get the recognition it deserves. But what do you think? Is sound something you've taken notice of while you play, or is it still subconscious to you? And what topics in development or specific games would you like to see me dive into next? Let me know down below, because I would love to discuss this with you. Also, a big thank you to Louise for letting me film on her island, because Animal Crossing is a time-gated internment camp of immense pain and suffering. I'm going to bed. Bye. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I really hope you enjoyed today's episode. And I just want to say a big thank you to Escapist and my wonderful patrons for actually making this possible. And if you too do enjoy this series and you want to see more, I actually have my own channel with lots of similar content over there. And I can't wait to see you over there as well as on here on The Escapist. Thank you so much for the support, mate. I'll see you in the next one.